continue on with our series on This Is Us. So we're going to talk about kids. Now, I know one of the first things you're going to say is, well, Pastor Vicki, you don't have kids. That is true. I do not have children. And it is a little difficult for those who are veterans to listen to someone who has not had children. But I did discover very early on that there is one thing that I enjoy more than having children, and that is sending them home to mom and dad. When I was young, I had my 7 nephews and nieces around, and so they would say, hey, can we send the kids over, or can we send a kid over to have you babysit? And I'm like, only if you send them all, because it's a whole lot easier to watch them all than it is to watch one of them, right? And so they just send them all over, and Uncle Ken and Aunt Vicki would be able to watch them, and we really enjoyed being able to do that. But then we also learned it's so enjoyable to be able to send them home to mom and dad, too. Well, let me tell you what I did for this series, for this subject. A couple things. Just because somebody doesn't have kids doesn't mean that the Bible doesn't speak to it. And it doesn't mean that that God doesn't have something to say to each one of us in the midst of all of it. But also, I make sure that I always do my research. Like, if anytime we talk about cooking, I have to do research about that too. So, you know, it's sort of the same thing. And I made sure that as we prepared these messages for This Is Us, that I read about, talked to, listened to parents who are veterans at being able to do this. And one of the books that I read was by Andy Stanley, and we're kind of using some of his outline for some of the things that we're doing with this series. And he talked about how when he became a parent, that he found parents who had were raising kids, and they loved the kids that they were raising, and they said, we would do everything we could to talk to them and say, how did you do that? Now, why did you, you know, do it this way instead of this way? To be able just to learn what it was to be a good parent, to be able to end up with kids that you want to be around. And he said, so we were very open. He said, we'd take them out to dinner and everything and just pepper them with questions. And it was kind of cool. He said, the one thing that I learned was that there's an order that you have to emphasize things. He said, one of my best friends said, you need to discipline your kids when they're little. You need to teach them as they grow. You need to coach them as they're teenagers. And then you enjoy their friendship as adults. He said, if you get this out of order, it messes everything up. If you don't discipline them, even when it's so hard and you're tired and you haven't had enough sleep and when they're teeny, and you try to do it when they're teenagers, it is not going to work. You're going to blow up your family. He said, if you try to be friends with them when they're in middle school, it is not going to work. He says, you got to get these in the right order. And he said, then it's going to be difficult no matter which way you do it. But if you discipline them first, teach them as they grow, coach them as teens, and enjoy their friendship as adults, he said, you're going to find that you're going to want to be together as a family. And in reading what he has to say and the different things that they did, the mistakes that they made, it got me to thinking about a teacher that I talked to. And she said, what I discovered was this. It's the first day of school. For the first 2 weeks, we work on discipline. I can teach them the rest of the year. If during the first 2 weeks of school I work on teaching, then we work on discipline the rest of the year. He said, if we set it straight early on, we're able to get a lot more done. I thought, that kind of sounds like parenting to me. But I think the thing as an outside observer that I've noticed for folks is they're carrying an awful lot of guilt and an awful lot of frustration because I think sometimes we get the wrong job description for parents. I think that we think that our job is to keep our kids out of pain and keep our kids from being afraid and keep our kids from failing. And as we do that, we end up frustrated and feeling guilty when inevitably life's challenges come. In fact, this is one of the things that they continue to deal with on the show, This Is Us. There's a scene where Kevin, the triplets have been taken to the pool. Mom's got her eye on one, dad's got his eye on the other, and that leaves Kevin with nobody watching him. And he goes to play in the pool and he almost drowns. And someone drags him out of the pool and rescues him. And he's angry and he's upset. And he runs up to his mom and dad and he said, you're so busy worrying about whether or not Kate's eating too much. And you're so worried about whether or not Randall's feeling too adopted that nobody noticed I needed you. I needed help. And it shows how they kind of overcompensate because they don't want their kids to get hurt. And how anytime they do this little bit, they praise them this much because they want them to be built up because they're afraid the kids are going to hurt their feelings at school. Or when they end up having a difficult situation, they try to solve it for them. And you can see them work through those issues because we get the wrong job description, thinking that our job is to keep them from those things or distract them from those things. But what if we had a different job description? What would it be like if one of your job descriptions for our kids and our grandkids was that we want to raise them in such a way that they want to hang out with us as adults? That we want to be able to have a good relationship with them as adults? Would that make a difference in how you made decisions? I mean, we can't correct every single thing they do wrong. If not, we get into that cycle of negativity, you know? You got to kind of pick which things, you know. What if the filter that we used for our kids and grandkids was, will this help us be in relationship, a healthy relationship, when they're adults? I thought that was an intriguing idea. I think it would make, be a good filter for decisions. The one that I think was most important as I thought about it in my life was to teach them that God has a plan for their lives and show them how to discover it. Teach them that God has a plan for their lives and show them how to discover it. Teach them very early on that God is going to speak to you and show them how to listen and then how to respond. This is probably the one that helped me the most. As I was reading the book by Andy Stanley, he gave the illustration how his parents did this for him too. And actually what it yielded was him making decisions well before he probably should have. And he said, because they taught me that God had a plan for me, God had something for me to be, to do, and that I needed to figure out what that was and follow in it. And he said, now we were Southern Baptists. Southern Baptists go to church on Sunday night. Well, there was going to be a concert. Elton John was coming to town, and he said, I loved Elton John. And so I said, Dad, can I go to the Elton John concert? And his dad says, well, son, you need to pray about it and see what God says. Now, he was sure that God was going to tell him no, that you should be in church on Sunday night, not out at some rock concert, right? And he said, so I took a week and I prayed about it. I didn't hear God saying anything. So I took that as a, it's okay for me to go. And he said, much to my parents' chagrin, but they let me make the decision. They didn't stop in and stop me because they said, you need to make this decision. You need to pray about it. He said, so I went to the concert. And he said, the whole time my parents are praying that I have a terrible time. They're praying that it's awful, and I come back going, oh, I'm never, ever going to do that again. And he said, I had a great time. And he said, not only that, but I came back wishing I was Elton John and wanting to be a rock star. And he said, every time somebody would ask me what it is I wanted to do when I grow up, he goes, seriously, my dad would put his hand over my mouth and say, he doesn't know yet. Because I would say, I want to be a rock star. And that wasn't okay for a Southern Baptist preacher to say. And so they taught him how to listen for God's voice, how to find what it is that God had for him, even if that meant that he made some decisions that they weren't exactly happy with. But it also helps to keep you out of trouble. And this is how I experienced it. I was called into ministry when I was 13 years old. My church had taught me that if you're breathing and you're a Christian, God has ministry for you. God has something important that you need to be and that you need to do. And so by the time I'm 13, I hear God speak to me that he wants me to go into full-time ministry. Now, I didn't understand it perfectly, didn't understand all the implications of it, but I said yes. And you know how much trouble that kept me out of? Because I had a direction. I had a purpose. I may not have understood all the plan, but I had a purpose and something I was headed towards. And I had a way to distinguish whether I ought to get involved with someone or not, whether I ought to hang out with a group of friends or another, because I had a very distinct understanding that God had something for me and that I didn't want to mess it up. What if we saw it as our job description? That by the time our kids and grandkids became adults, they understood that God had a plan for them, and they wanted to follow that way. Instead of seeing our job as the important people in little people's lives, as keeping them from pain, I think it's exactly the opposite. I think that we have to show them how to have courage to work through their fear. We have to let them fail while the stakes are low, instead of their first failure being when they're off at college and they flunk a class or they max out their credit cards and end up filing bankruptcy at 21. We let them fail while the stakes are low. We let them fail while we can be there guiding them and with them. I think that our job description is, how do we teach them to deal through their pain? I was doing some research this week, and they came out with statistics about what they're calling Generation Z. Now, Generation Z is the generation after the millennials, because everything we hear about now is the millennials. But Generation Z are those folks that are about teenagers right now. And in the midst of it, as teenagers, they're just now getting old enough that they're thinking about God, they're able to answer questions, and they said, this is the generation that is the most unreligious that we've ever had. And I said, of all of those who are unreligious, do you know why? He said, overwhelmingly, the answer was because of the problem of pain. They don't believe in God because bad things happened to good people. Now, that sounds a whole lot to me like somebody had the wrong job description. Because it sounds to me like they think the job description of God, the Heavenly Father, is to keep them from being in pain. And if I am in pain and if bad things happen, then God didn't do God's job. So God must not be there, or God must not be good. But either way, I don't want anything to do with him. An entire generation rejecting God because they think his job description is to keep them from pain. I wonder where they learned that from. I wonder if we could do differently. I wonder if we could look at him and say, I know it hurts. I know you're afraid. I know you don't want to fail. But I promise you can get through this. I promise you'll be okay. You don't have to distract yourself from it, and you don't have to avoid it. You have what it takes to march right through it. Where do we get this idea? Well, that's our scripture today. It's what it means to be part of Lent. It's what it means to be on the journey towards Jesus. Let's read what he has to say. They went to the place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here. Keep watch. Going a little further, he fell to the ground, and he prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will be done. This is exactly what's happening here. Jesus knows that he's facing this separation. He knows that he's facing this pain. He knows that he's facing the worst thing that he's ever going to have to go through. And he said, Dad, can't you do something about this? Can't we avoid this? Isn't there some other way? But God has to say no. You've got to walk right through the middle of this to be who you are. If you think about it, what you want your children to be, you want them to be kind, and you want them to be wise, you want them to be strong. There's only one way to get that. And it's not by avoiding pain, and it's not by distracting yourself from fear. It is by looking it right in the eyes and walking right on through it, exactly the way Jesus showed us to. Because you can do this. I know you can. I know it's difficult. I know it sucks. But you're not alone, and I'm here with you. You can do it. And I'll be here to help. Not distracted, not avoiding. Walking headlong into it. Just the way the followers of Christ were shown to do in our journey. We have what it takes to get through this. I want to take a minute to do something that I've not done yet. And that is, I want to address what's been going on in our country, what's happened in our schools. I want to talk about and help us to deal with the fear and the pain that we've experienced not only this week, but in past weeks and in past years together. First of all, my heartfelt sympathies for those who lost children, husbands, wives this week. For those who are having to console their children because they had to witness these atrocities. For those who have lost loved ones. And for those who walk into school now scared every day. Every one of us wants our kids and our grandkids to be safe. Now, the remarks I'm about ready to make, I don't want to reference this particular incident because we are long on emotion and very short on facts. When something like this happens, it is very easy to get angry. It's very easy to jump in, start debating. It's very easy to let our emotions do most of the talking. But it is so easy because we seem to have two ways that we want to deal with this. One group, at least if it's according to my Facebook feed, one group wants to make sure that we ban guns everywhere so that our kids are safe. And we need to picket, and we need to write our congressmen, and we need to do everything we can to make our kids safe by getting guns out of the way. Another group wants to arm everybody. They want to arm the teachers, or they want to get metal detectors, or they want to get armed security. They want to do something to get guns in schools. I guess there's a third group, and that's some Christians who are like, every day those kids need to be saying the Pledge of Allegiance and praying. That'll solve this. And they seem like those are two different ways of dealing with the issue, two opposite ways of dealing with the issue, two irreconcilable ways to deal with this. I want to submit to you that they are the same way of dealing with this. Stick with me here. Every single one of those ways looks for someone else to solve the problem. Every single one of those ways looks for someone else to do something about this. Every single one of those ways makes the responsibility for this somebody out there that we can write to, that we can complain to, that we can picket, that we can legislate. Every single one of those ways is what somebody else can do to solve this. But the thing that Christ teaches us is that these things can only be solved in relationship. That is the gospel. God tried the whole law thing, and he sent Jesus for the relationship. Because that was the key to life change. Now, I don't care if you write your congressman. I don't care if you picket. I don't care if you want guns in schools or guns out of schools. That is your business. That is not mine. Okay? But let me talk for a few minutes about what the gospel calls us as Christians to. Because everybody who's on your Facebook feed or your social media feed are telling you that Jesus would do it their way. I think with certainty, the only thing we could say is that Jesus calls us to deal with these things in relationship, period. And the rest you have to work out. Why? Because nobody, no adult, no child walks into a school and harms a child unless they've become so disconnected from themselves, from their family, from their community, and from God. And it is that disconnection that is at the heart of this. And people who are saying, this is causing the breakdown of our society. This is because of the breakdown of our society. This is because we've become so disconnected from one another. Because we've become so disconnected from ourselves. It's the only way that any person would be able to harm a child in the way that they have done. So what does that mean? We're not going to solve this by getting somebody else to do something. It's going to be solved by what you do. It's going to get solved by what I do. It's going to get solved by what our church does in our community. Relationship is the only way this is going to work. We have something that I think is one of the frontline things that we do as a church. We started a program this year at the school called Project More. Well, the United Way started it. We called it our hero reading team. And what we do is we go in every day for a half an hour and we read with kids. Because it is the one single way that we as lay people have to be able to help those kids stay connected. Because if a kid can't read, they're much more likely to drop out of school. Up until third grade, they're learning how to read. After third grade, they're reading in order to learn. If we can intervene before they get to that point, that crucial point, we can set them on a foundation that says that I can learn and I can grow. I was talking with Adam this week, who's the head of the program, and granted, we've had a lot of bumbles getting this thing started. It was brand new at the school. School didn't know what they were doing. We've gone through two or three different people from United Way. I mean, the training was 10 times harder than it should have been. There's just a whole lot of things that was difficult to get this thing going. And people got discouraged and they wanted to quit. And it is so difficult because we don't connect the dots between that half hour that we spend trying to keep that precocious little kid in his seat reading and what happens that's on CNN when there's a tragedy. I want to connect those dots for you. I want you to see that when you step out and you get are willing to take those, that fear of failure, when you're willing to work through the thing, you know what? We do this at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, maybe 5 o'clock on some days. That's when I need my nap. And instead of taking my nap, I'm wrestling this kid to the ground, trying to get him to play this game so he can learn his sight words. It takes energy. It's painful sometimes. And yet, we do it because there's a link between that kid being able to read and whether or not they're a 17-year-old who doesn't drop out of school and stays connected. We're not doing this for grins and giggles, okay? I'm not just up here suggesting we do stuff so that we're good people. We are saving children's lives. and it takes a half an hour and a whole lot of patience and care. Now, it's not the only thing that God's going to call us to do. It's just the first thing that God's called us to do since I've been here. Okay? The first thing that we've tried. But it is exactly the way it works. We risk failing. We risk it not working. We risk people being irritated because they show up and they didn't bring the kids down today or whatever it is. But we do those things and we work through the frustration, we work through the fear, and we work through the failures, we work through the pain because it keeps them connected, because we are having that relationship with that child so that they can read and they will stay in school. The chili cook-off, we raised $1,000 so that we can give food to the kids that don't have food when they go home, or they don't go home from the weekend. Because you know what they do? They walk in on Monday, and they can't even focus on their lessons because they haven't had enough calories over the weekend to be able to keep their little brains functioning properly. But we can send food home with them so that we know that they'll have something because we cared. Do you think that helps them feel connected? That somebody else cares about them? It's the first thing we've been called to. It's not the only thing we're going to be called to. I don't know what that's going to look like. What I know is this is the way it's going to go. That there's going to be a teacher or a bus driver or the lunch lady who's going to say, "Hey, I need help. Can the church help us with this?" There's going to be somebody who is realizing that God has a plan for their life and a purpose for who they are and what they're supposed to do, and this is going to burn in their soul. And they're going to come and say, "Pastor Vicki, I think God's calling me to this." And we're going to say, "Wonderful. Find two or three other people that God's calling to as well. We will come alongside of you and we will do everything we can to help you with this." Why? Because you might be afraid, because it might fail, and it might be painful, but I know you can do it. I know you can do it. There's not one of these children who do these horrible things that has not become disconnected because of their pain. There may be other issues involved, but can we help them work through their pain? It's what Jesus taught us. Stare it right in the eyes and say, "I can do this." Because the fact of it is, God believes in you more than you believe in yourself. And God wants your kids and your grandkids safe even more than you do. And he's going to use his church and people who are willing to build relationships in order to do that. You see, everybody else, they get to throw money at this. They get to send off their tax dollars and be done with it. But as Christians, we can't. Because the love of Christ compels us that even in the middle of the garden, saying, "Can't we get away from this?" No. It is straight through the fear. It is straight through the pain. It is becoming who God's created us to be so that the world might be saved. Now, we can't walk in there and say we're doing this because we're church people. It's okay. The love of Christ is universal. And it makes a difference whether or not we get to name the name of Christ to do it. So, I usually end with my challenge for what I'd like for you to do. Not exactly sure. But I know what that is. I I can tell you that our Project Moore has brought the kids from A, B, and C level to D, F, and G level. That our goal is to get them to M by the time they're in third grade, and we have successfully, in our program, brought them up three levels just since the first of the school year. Maybe God's calling you to be part of it. Maybe God's calling you back to it, and you can take those steps. Or maybe God has something else for you. Maybe it's to lower the volume on social media a little bit and make it more about relationships than debate. I don't know what God's going to lead you to, but God has a plan for you, and God has a plan for us, and we're going to listen, and then we're going to act on it, and we're going to do what God has asked us to do. So I want to take time to pray for all of us to hear what it is that God's calling us to. But I also want us to take time to pray for every single person who steps foot in that school, in your school, in our school. Whether you're a bus driver or an administrator, whether you serve lunches or you teach, whether you're active or retired, I'm going to ask you if you would come forward and if you would stand here so that we might be able to also pray for you who are on the front lines every day. Would you please come forward? These are the folks that have served us by serving our kids and our grandkids. These are the ones who every day pour themselves into little lives. We are the ones who can help support them to help keep those kids connected. We will be listening for what God says to you. We will be listening for how we as the people of God can help. And we will be praying for you, for your safety, and for every one of those little lives that you touch. I'm going to ask if you'll join in that prayer by just putting your hands out towards them that we might pray together. Lord God, I want to thank you for every person here, every person that we know you have a plan, we know that you have a purpose for them, not just for what they do, but for who they are. And God, I thank you for the people who stand at this altar today. I want to thank you that they've dedicated their lives to pouring into little hearts, to helping them to be the best they can be by helping them learn and grow. And I know it's tough. I know they only have so many hours, and people have ridiculous expectations for what they're going to be able to do. I know so many of their kids come to school with not only their bellies empty, but their hearts empty too. Their tanks, little tanks, need filled up with attention and care. And I know it seems overwhelming for them. So I ask God that you would help them to feel your presence, to feel your power, to feel your sustaining them. Help them when they feel discouraged to know we can look this right in the eye. And we can make it through because you are with us. And on the other side of this challenge and on the other side of this struggle will be salvation for our kids. Now, God, we've answered your call to help. We don't know everything that that's going to mean. We don't know all of the plan, but we do know you have a purpose for our church. And part of that purpose is to help these kids stay connected, to build relationships, to stay stand in the gap for them. And so I ask that you would speak to each of us, that we may fulfill your purpose as a church. It'll be scary, we may fail, certainly will be awfully inconvenient. And yet we will walk through it and do it because you showed us how. And because you believe in us even more than we believe in ourselves. Pray for your blessing upon each person here, each person standing in this row. I pray for your protection upon them and for your grace and your overwhelming strength to be theirs. And it is in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.